I am not an expert, more so on urban sector. Neither am I a planner, neither I do not consider myself an expert. I still consider myself as a practitioner and learner. What I speak here today will be on some of the work that, as part of WWF, we have done in Moradabad, which is a city. So we work within the Ganga Basin. That's been an area of our work. And through cities, we have looked at developing an integrated urban water management framework. To begin with, when we talk of WWF, the first impression that comes, apart from the name that we shared with another organization for different reasons, so there were some, you know, like legal battles that we had to win by with the name, but the first impression that we get with WWF is a conservation organization, and we could relate to Panda. And in discourses and discussions where we go, I guess a lot of the times, as we go and speak in different fora, one of the questions that comes to us that, you know, why, you know, what is the relation to the panda or conservation or tigers or rhinos to something like urban or something new areas that we are working in, business, markets, and forests. So I guess, you know, I work with the rivers, wetlands, and water policy team in WWF, and the focus of our work is on the Ganga Basin, and we are working on a tributary of Ganga called as Ram Ganga. Ram Ganga, if you know, how many of you will have been to Corbett? Yeah, so you would have seen the river which flows through the Corbett, that's the Ram Ganga. And in case anybody of you had a chance to visit Moradabad or Bareilly, anybody has seen, visit? Yeah, so have you seen the river, have you seen the Ram Ganga in Moradabad and Bareilly? In Bareilly, yeah. So I guess you can see, you know, if you do a comparison of what the Ram Ganga is in Corbett and what is in Moradabad and Bareilly, it's completely a contrast. And our work is on the four pillars of habitats and species, which is, you know, fundamental to the conservation work that we do. And we look at the conservation of the Gangetic River dolphin, which is a national aquatic animal, and the gharial and the freshwater turtles. There's a sustainable water management work where we are looking at environmental flows. A student of ours mentioning that, you know, he had some reference on the building block methodology that we have developed to look at e-flows for Ram Ganga and Ganga. The third aspect of our work is water stewardship, which comprises urban and industrial, and I'm going to speak very briefly about the urban work and why it is important in the larger context of Ganga, Ram Ganga, and our rivers. And the fourth one is climate change adaptation, where we are looking at, you know, agriculture and improving the resilience of farmers. Now, we are sitting in Delhi, the capital of India, a city which is, you know, highly urban. Why do you feel, you know, is the need to talk about, you know, like urban? And I guess this is something, you know, which is, I'm sure it's known to a lot of people, you know, across the last few years, we are seeing that India is urbanizing. So with, you know, like repeated sensors have shown that the growth rate in our urban areas is increasing. The pressures on urban areas is increasing. And it is estimated that by 2025, almost close to 50% of the population of this country will be living in urban centers. Urban centers, I'll come on to the pressures part a little later. So if you look at the water scenario, and there were a lot of data and statistics which I thought, you know, I will not put, but to build a background on why urban management and why a framework for urban water and wastewater management is important, I thought I'll look at two aspects. One is the scenario with regard to the availability of water. Now, the blue line that you see here is the Central Public Health Engineering Organization norm, which says that, you know, for cities like metros, there's a 150 LPCD norm, which is, you know, prescribed. And what we see here is that most of the cities, and this is a average values, most of the cities have water supply ranging, you know, which is sometimes lower and sometimes more than the average. But there's a stark differentiation which I want to point out here. So, you know, when we say for any city you take, when we say a certain value of liters per capita is available, it is not available uniform. Even in Delhi, when we look at it, you know, the areas, one, which are under DJB supply, and there are areas which are not under, you know, any supply, DJB or a DDA supply, but uses groundwater as a source of water. There is disparity in the amount of water, and the timeliness and the duration is something that is a concern, irrespective of which city you live. Can you go to the next slide, please? Yeah, and then this, I think, is an important aspect to look at, because we always see, you know, the concept of a welfare state and a notion that, you know, water is something that we should get. But you have to realize that the water that you are getting in your taps, there's a cost which is being incurred. So from lifting it to the source, or, you know, drawing it out from the ground, most of the ground water sources are based on groundwater. So the cost that you incur from lifting water to the ground to, you know, your taps and into your glass incurs a certain cost. And not always. This is, you know, some figures from some of the cities where you will see that the average tariff at times do not meet the production cost, which essentially puts a question on the efficiency of the utilities we are providing. While at one point, and I know that there have been arguments and counter arguments on the whole aspect of providing water as a free, there was a lot of debate when the government in the city announced that they will, you know, like provide free water to a certain limit to a certain number of households. But I guess the fact that it is important as a user to loan, and there are a lot of, you know, young people, I see students also here, is that the water that you get in your taps, the water that you flush, the water that you bathe, there's a huge cost that is being incurred to, you know, get that water to your household. And as you can see, and what we are paying is certainly not, you know, which is commensurating with the cost that is coming. So be conscious of the fact that the utilities are incurring cost, and you have a responsibility of seeing that that water is not being wasted. Can you go to the next slide, please? I talk about Moradabad. Moradabad is a city which is located on the banks of Ram Ganga. It is the first major habitation, urban habitation in Ram Ganga. Moradabad is known as the Pital Nagri, the city which has famous for its brass and the metalware industry. And this has been one area of our work where we have tried to work with the urban utilities, the citizens, the parastatal bodies to develop a urban water management framework involving the citizens, because we have felt that, you know, as long as the plans and policies are made by the government with limited scope of people to engage, things are a little difficult. So Moradabad, like, you know, most of the cities as we've seen in the Ganga Basin, it's 100% dependence on groundwater. Ram Ganga is a groundwater fed river, so essentially the flow of flow in Ram Ganga is also dependent. So because while there are some rivers which are, you know, fed by glaciers, there are others like the Ram Ganga which are flowed by, you know, like seasonal springs and streams and groundwater. So there's a groundwater feeding the Ram Ganga, and because the city is so dependent on groundwater, there is an impact on the overall state of water availability and quality on the river. Moradabad, the city which is, you know, has got close to 9 lakh people, does not have, most of the part is, you know, unsewered. There are no proper lines. The government and the Nagar Nigam is putting sewer lines. The 100% sewage is disposed in Ram Ganga and the other wetlands of the city, which poses not only a health risk but also to the biodiversity. I guess when we, you know, look into history and literature, there were times, you know, around 57 years ago where the gangetic dolphin was said to be reported in stretches of Bareilly and Moradabad also, but now we don't see that. Wetlands, urban water bodies is something that, you know, is not the plight of the urban water bodies is something that is not particular to Moradabad, but all across cities in our country. Moradabad, which had 90 wetlands within the city limits, when we did a census of wetlands in Moradabad, we found out that 33 have, you know, they don't exist, you know, in the land records that you see. They have their list, but we can't physically see them. But the point that I'm making is that, you know, these urban water bodies, the lakes, the ponds, served as a source of water. They were catchments, and this is an area where, you know, like biodiversity could thrive. But this is something that has gone missing, not only in Moradabad, but a lot of the cities in our country. Next. So if we look at, you know, like the current scenario of water management in Moradabad, and I guess which, as I said, is a reflection of a lot of the other towns. So what you see here is this groundwater. As I said, the city lifts all its water from groundwater. Then there is a supply. It's provided to households. There are some places where there are pipe connections. Some places people use their own boring. Then there is the use, and there is a wastewater discharge. Wastewater discharge goes out into open. So this, we feel, the, so this is what the current scenario of water management in Moradabad is. Can you go to the next slide, please? And what we are talking of the integrated urban water management is to effectively close the loop, where, you know, there is abstraction, there is usage, there is wastewater discharge, but how do you get to use that water, wastewater, treat it, use it for some other purpose, and also look at, you know, means of augmenting the source. So when we look at drinking water, I guess a lot of the drawback that has been is that we have only looked at, you know, the service delivery side of coverage, but we have not looked at source sustainability. Even when I look at the guidelines for drinking water supply of both Ministry of Urban and Rural Development, still the focus largely remains on coverage, excess. While it is certainly important to have excess and coverage, but how are you going to ensure that excess remains? I looked at the manifestos of SP, BSP, BJP and Congress that they announced for the UP Vidhan Sabha election. Everybody said that we will provide 24/7 water to all the cities of UP. But with groundwater being a major source, there is nothing in the manifestos or the plan for governance that how that source will be sustained. So the fact is, looking at source sustainability as well as looking at, you know, measures on how you treat the wastewater and use it is something that we tried to attempt in this urban water management framework. Can you go to the next slide, please? I guess when we looked at IUWN, a lot of the, you know, we have students, I don't know how much it'll, you know, capture your attention, but I guess for others, you know, students and the faculty, I guess what we realize is that in terms of, you know, our planning and decision making, where we begin with is the stage of the DPR, the detailed project report development, and then so there are two aspects to it. The one which are circles which are shaded, you know, which are in white, and one which are in blue. And we realized with the work with, you know, working with utilities, we realized a lot of the work and our strength lies in the four circles which is on the top. We know how to make a DPR. We are good at, you know, making figures on funding and allocation. Then we do pilot and then we look at scale up. What we miss certainly is the back end part of all this, stakeholder mapping, capacity assessment, institutional mapping, baselines, a common vision. I guess, you know, whenever, you know, like you look at any city sanitation plan or a plan for you, they are, you know, targets of ensuring, as I said, complete coverage by a certain year. But, you know, is it a common vision? Do citizens also, you know, feel part of that common vision? So what we proposed as part of the IUWM framework for Moradabad is to look at these aspects, the new steps recommended. And we felt that, you know, any planning, and I speak here with the case of the urban, is something which is, you know, which has got three stages: preparation, design, and implementation. But there's a need to look back. You know, like it, you can't follow a linear process of just a preparation, design, and implementation. But there's a need to relook your strategies with regard to program design as well as preparation. There are some elements on stakeholder engagement, monitoring and evaluation, and operation maintenance which stretch across the entire spectrum of activities that you do. But the two points, if I were to highlight in this, and you know, is that the fact is that if you were to look at a better urban management framework, you need to have these four, five, or six set of activities to provide a strong baseline, to provide a strong genesis and basis for the projects that you are to build. And go to the next slide, please. So this was for the overall IUWM framework, and I guess for each one of this, we made a journey on where the city lies and what are the steps that it needs to do. These are the five aspects which we looked at: water supply, which is essentially, you know, like how water will come in your tap. Second is wastewater management, how, what are the ways and means of, you know, treating the wastewater and reuse. Storm water management, a lot of the water that, you know, comes as rain goes as storm water in our cities and towns. What are the ways that storm water could be better managed? Solid waste management and ecosystem conservation for land use planning. And we, I guess when there's this aspect of any technology, we tend to look at technology or any project which is, you know, high in cost and large infrastructure projects. Are there any ecosystem-based ways of treating the waste? Are there any natural ways of, you know, floodplain management is something that we looked at. And ultimately what binds them is institutions and processes. For students who are here, you would know that, you know, like with regard to the urban reforms, which began with the 72nd and 73rd amendment respectively for panchayats and urban local bodies, there were a lot of effort on knowledge management, building the strength and capacities of the urban local bodies, and institution and processes are still fundamental to a lot of the things if we were to achieve. Can you go to the next slide, please? I guess what is important, you know, when we try to map out just the number of schemes from where we could get money for implementing a IUWM framework for Moradabad, and the list was, you know, list and the number of departments that, you know, had these schemes across this area was huge. So I guess what, and we speak about this, we know that, you know, this is something that has been spoken at length about convergence. There are money across different departments. Water is managed across departments and ministries in this country. There are projects, programs. How do you, where do you get them to converge? And I guess at some point of time we have realized that, you know, at a district level, if, you know, all the planning could be converged and the allocation of resources could be done, might be a useful, but then there are also, you know, technicalities and institutional arrangements which needs to be worked upon. But just, you know, this is just an example of Moradabad. So if we were to look at water supply, wastewater, wash, solid waste management, there are different programs and, you know, which are managed by different departments, and how we bring about a convergence of schemes is something that is critical for us to go forward. Next. I guess this is, so I spoke about the framework which was more to do with, you know, at what is there for a utility, for a Nagar Nigam, for a Moradabad Development Authority to look at. But I guess one aspect of the whole water and wastewater management is also users. And as I said, you know, when we, as users, we have a fundamental duty to kind of look at ways where we can, you know, reduce the amount of water that we use. We realize that, okay, if we are working with the authorities and utilities on developing a framework, we need to work with the citizens also. And what we thought could be a nice way to engage with them is to involve them through a water footprint campaign. This was a partnership with Moradabad Development Authority, and we, the objective that we set out, because we had a 5-6 months time to do this, was to reduce the water footprint of 1,000 households by 20%. And I guess first when we began, people said that, why are you even doing it? you know, why there is a need to kind of do something like this. To the which, when I asked, do you actually know how much is the volume of water that we use? So they said, haan, 500 liter ka tanki hai, din mein do baar bharte hain 1000 liter. So, but then, you know, when we got them to, you know, have a look at the calculation and to measure what is the amount of water that we use, the figures were struggling, and I'll speak about it. So I guess this was a demonstration case for us and for the city authorities to identify and adopt demand management for interventions in Moradabad. This is just the beginning, and we know that we have a long way to go. Can you go to the next slide, please? Yeah, so I guess when we looked at, so we said that we will target 1,000 households, but I guess the response, I guess that we got were overwhelming. Around 1,500 households participated. And when we measure the direct and indirect, the direct water footprint is the amount of water that you use for, you know, your drinking, bathing, washing, cleaning purposes. So the average figure, the average direct water footprint of households, and the rough approach the household side is, you know, anyways from, you know, 4 to 7 people, is 4,175 liters for the city of Moradabad. And this ranges, as I said, this is not uniform. There are some households which use 1,200 liters, and there are some which use 12,000 liters as well. So there's this huge range. When it came to indirect footprint, and I guess, you know, what we realize that this figure is grossly underreported. Indirect footprint is what you calculate on the basis of, you know, the amount of paper that you use, the amount of plastics that you use, the amount of the other things like, you know, the kind of clothes that you wear. So water has, you know, one that you directly use and one which is used for, you know, making products. The indirect water footprint, which, I mean, we still feel that the figure of 217 liters per household is grossly underreported. But I guess it was the first attempt for people to actually even measure the amount of paper plastics that they use. And I guess this is something that we need to work upon. But the range also, as I said, is, you know, from 80 to 1800 liters. In terms of the average demand and consumption, you know, as I said, the CPHO norms for a city like Moradabad is like 135. But the average consumption, people in Moradabad are using almost 4.5 to 5 times more water. And that's primarily because there's groundwater, it's unregulated, you know, whenever you, there's a need for you to get water, you kind of put it on your motors. There's variation also, but the two broad facts is, you know, people are certainly using more water than what, you know, the norms prescribe. Can you go to the next part? Yeah, and this is like just a further detailing on where did we find maximum amount of, you know, footprint usage. Certainly in the direct category, bathroom had the largest share of water usage, and indirect plastics and paper comprises the bulk of the water usage. Why did we do this? Why, you know, so one, the question that we repeatedly get asked is that, okay, you're very, you know, you looked at research, you looked at baseline data collection, you looked at developing frameworks. Why do you feel this is so very important? And the reason that, the answer that I could find is, you know, to, for anybody, you know, for anybody to make a judgment, you know, to talk about conservation is important, but to kind of have a starting point, you really need to know what your footprint is, what is the impact that you are creating on the water resources. And this gave us a starting point to build that conversation with the public. The last slide to sum up is what, you know, I thought, the next slide, please. In terms of, you know, water and wastewater management for our urban cities and towns, I guess what we need is that there's certainly need for strong baselines. Even, you know, a lot of the cities with the smart city program that the government of India has, they are setting up proposals, they are getting consultants to do their proposals, but we strongly feel that there's a need for strong baselines because cities really lack the data. Even if they have the data, it's not in a form which could be presented. Develop risk narratives for different users. We work in Kanpur also. Kanpur is a place which is also on the Ganga. We work with the tanneries there and with the urban people there. And we find that, you know, whenever you do a risk narrative, it is very different from a different user. Industry people in Kanpur, his narrative of risk and water is very different from the urban citizens of Kanpur is. So it's important to develop the risk narrative for different users. Whenever you plan, you can't have, you know, common risk narratives for different users. There are certainly concerns with regard to the governance, use and management of water, which would be common. But I guess certainly if you are able to engage with different users to develop their risk narratives and find solutions, it's a helpful. Evaluate the choice of technology. As I said, not, you know, something which is, you know, expensive is valuable, but there's a need to look at technologies. Options for using sewage for non-potable purposes, I guess, and this is something that has been doing rounds, I guess, in cities of South India particularly, they are, there is talks of, you know, how does the treated wastewater is used for industrial purposes and not ones where quality is important, but for service water. And we know that, you know, the wastewater of the Bangalore International Airport will be used as an input water for non-industrial purposes of Doddaballapur, which is like located some distance. So this is, you know, one way. But I know there are questions of infrastructure, there are questions of pricing and other aspects. Carefully assess groundwater reserves. Groundwater, major source of water, unregulated, used extensively, but You really need to know where your aquifer is. You really need to know where, because any conservation method for Moradabad to do water harvesting and conservation and recharge does not mean that Moradabad should harvest in only, you know, in its urban or municipal limits, because the aquifer boundaries do not, you know, overlay with the political boundaries. So the recharge areas for Moradabad might be further upstream, downstream. So assessment of the groundwater and the aquifers is important, and I guess there certainly has to be space for users to engage. At the end of the day, it is people who are using the water. At the end of the day, it is the people who, and we fall all, you know, we individuals as users of water have a role to play in the larger ecosystem. And I guess any framework for urban water management or any water management need to have space for users to engage. Thank you.